Welcome our viewers to our another episode of Gospel Chats, a program of Covenant Baptist Church Nakuru. Thank you for watching for all these other episodes, and we hope and pray that the Lord is building your faith, you understanding things. You are also very much welcome to send in your questions to the numbers that have been given by Covenant Baptist Church. We would like to get to know you. We would like to have fellowship with you. We would like to explain some of the things we are dealing with in these episodes. And feel free to contact us via our phone number or even your Facebook, Covenant Baptist Church, or you can visit our website, cbcnakuru.org. So this next episode, we are going to look at how a Christian responds to what God has done in his own life. We all know that God saves, as we saw in the last episode. God saves, and God is the one who has ordained us to be saved. God lives in us in the way of his Holy Spirit. But also we know we are not passive in our Christianity. God has not saved us and left us to be like robots who need to be tuned left and right. We have a duty to do. When you read Philippians chapter 2 and from verses 12, Paul says in these words, "Work out your salvation with fear and trembling, because it's God who is working in you." And so we want to look at this last in this session we are dealing with, which is one of the last sessions on Ephesians chapter 2, and we want to see what is the response. How should a Christian respond now that God has worked in his life and he has made him a Christian? With me is Brother Joseph Chege. Welcome, brother, to the episode.
Thank you so much, Pastor.
Good to have you.
Yeah.
And we, as our normal days, we always three of us, but as you can see today, we are two. Mm-hmm. And not because the matter we are going to deal with is less weighty, or it's not very important. Not that's the case, but as we have been dealing with other matters, we are going to deal with also this matter with the seriousness it takes. Mm-hmm. Brother Joseph,
yes.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you so much.
When we think about the gospel, mm-hmm. and to our viewers, this is going to be more interactive, more discussional. When we think about the gospel, we have said, man, we are naturally sinners,
yeah.
and we have no power to respond mm-hmm. to God unless God works in us.
Yes.
And we have seen Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4, the Bible reminds us clearly that it's God who has worked in us.
Yeah.
It's God who has saved us. It's mm-hmm. God who has brought us to his Son. It's God who found us in sin.
Exactly.
And he has saved us. He has redeemed us from us. He has blessed us so much
yeah.
with all spiritual blessings in Christ.
Yes.
How should we respond mm-hmm. to such a great salvation?
Exactly. We respond, first of all, because God has worked, as you have said.
Yeah.
He has made us alive,
mm.
and in the previous episodes, that has become clear.
Yes.
He has raised us together with Christ, but Christ died 2,000 years ago.
Mm.
So for the sinner to experience that, to be part, to fellowship in that reality of Christ dying because of sin, or for sin, and being buried, and being raised, it takes now hearing the gospel and by the work of God being brought mm-hmm. into faith
yeah.
and repentance. And this faith is to look to Christ and to look at Christ and actually see him as the source mm-hmm. of salvation,
mm-hmm.
as the only hope,
mm-hmm.
to see him in his glory.
Yes.
To see him now, not just in theory,
yeah.
but as a matter of heart rejoicing in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And surrendering to Christ. And repentance, turning away from the things that I used to follow,
mm.
and now coming now to Christ. And he becomes my life, my Lord, my Savior, my inheritance, my treasure, my newfound master.
Mm.
Yeah. So we respond by this work of being raised.
Mm-hmm.
Is actually what John will say. I will write that Christ told Nicodemus, You cannot see the kingdom of God unless you are born,
born again,
born from above.
Yeah.
And then he continues to say, born of spirit mm-hmm. and water, born of the Holy Spirit in the heart. Mm. And the work of the word likened to
the water
mm. washing our hearts and yeah. our minds. Mm. And now we start to taste mm. that the Lord is good and to follow him.
Mm.
Yes.
It's very important that, you know, we talk about things like to do with faith, mm-hmm. That the faith is the very way we respond to what God has done for us. And in Ephesians 2, we are reminded,
yes, yeah.
even that faith is not from us.
Exactly.
It's a mm. gift from God.
Yes.
In reality, man has no place of boasting mm. completely in salvation.
Exactly.
It's a total mm. leaning and being thankful to what God is
yeah.
has done for us. Mm-hmm. And yet this faith is not a passive faith.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, you don't have believed, mm-hmm. then nothing, you know, mm-hmm. like, you know, sleep in your bed or mm-hmm. do nothing.
Yeah.
It's faith that is mm-hmm. active.
Exactly.
And I want to look at exactly mm-hmm. what this faith looks like.
Yeah.
You know, when we talk about active faith, even before we look at the three things, when mm-hmm. we talk about active faith, what mm-hmm. is this active faith?
Mm-hmm. Active faith. Because we when you say active and living faith, true faith, we mean there is a false faith.
Mm.
And I think James brings that out when he says, even the demons believe.
Yeah.
And they shudder.
Yeah.
they have reached a place where we have not reached ourselves.
This, yeah.
They know there is God.
Yeah.
And I think now the true faith is opposite of mm. that dead faith.
Mm.
It is not just knowing mm-hmm. that there is God.
Mm.
It is acting on that knowledge.
Yeah.
It's not just knowing that I'm a sinner.
Mm-hmm.
It is acting on that knowledge.
Mm.
That's why we are saying repentance. It is a faith that hates sin.
Mm.
And hates the life that was of the former self.
Mm-hmm.
It is a faith that now comes to Christ.
Yeah.
So that's why we're talking about the first work that this faith will show itself in is repentance.
Yeah.
Is that change of mind, change of affections, change of worldview, change of desires.
Yeah.
And now there's a newness about my life
mm.
because I've turned. So that faith is already has started to show that it is now active. Because the devils know that there is God, but they don't act on that knowledge
mm.
in terms of running to him. Actually, they can't.
Yeah.
They have been locked out of that grace. But the grace that has been given is that through faith, we may now move to God
mm.
and come to him and now start to work out our salvation. As you have said, Philippians 2, 12 to 13, work out your salvation with fear and trembling because it is God at work in us.
Mm.
So it is, actually, faith is responding to what God is doing in us
mm.
by the word and by the Holy Spirit.
That's a great thing. What you know, when we talk about our former ways in mm-hmm. Ephesians chapter 2,
mm-hmm.
we ask ourselves this question. How yeah. new is a Christian from his or her old nature
mm-hmm.
in sin?
You yeah.
In relation to 2 Corinthians 5, 17,
mm-hmm. yeah.
where we are told a Christian is a new creature, mm-hmm. the old
mm-hmm.
has gone.
Yeah.
How does a Christian, you know, how new is that Christian
mm-hmm.
in relationship mm-hmm. to the old nature?
Yeah. A Christian... And here we come now to this great theme of creation that is in the Bible. Anyone who comes to the scriptures and even start to read the Bible for him or herself
mm.
will see that God has deliberately started the Bible with creation. With saying, before there was nothing,
mm.
but God said, let there be.
Yeah.
And we see the beautiful creation that God, at the end of chapter 2, we are told that God saw. What he had made,
mm,
it was very, very, very good. And he was satisfied in what he had done.
Yeah.
And the apex of creation is man, made in the image of God,
mm.
to show the glory of God in the world.
Mm.
And so right from the beginning, even in the gospel, we are now brought to the same theme of creation. Because as you have said, this is the work of God.
Mm.
Only God can create. We are talking about life in death. Only God has that power.
Mm.
And so when we say that a Christian is a new creation, we are intimating or meaning that now God is doing a new thing. The first creation was marred by sin,
mm.
by rebellion from Satan, infected that rebellion into humanity, and our first parents dragged us into that rebellion when we were born, we agreed with Adam and Eve, as we saw in verse 2 and 3.
Yeah.
We did this so joyfully, following the course of the world in sin, and actually hating God, wanting nothing to do with God. But here, through the gospel, God has done a new thing.
Mm.
So when we say new creation, you're not saying that a Christian has completely been removed from the world.
No,
we are saying a Christian has shared in something new that God is doing. And God is doing this in Jesus Christ. And therefore that great theme of the apostles when they are writing, in Christ. It is in Christ you are chosen. It is in Christ you are sanctified. It is in Christ you are saved. It is in Christ that you are made partakers of the inheritance of God. It is in Christ, in Christ, in Christ.
Yeah.
So the newness we are talking about here is the union with Jesus Christ through the new birth and through identification with what Jesus did on the cross.
Yeah.
We are counted to share in it. By faith we are brought into its reality, that sin in me has now been dealt with decisively. Although it is not completely done with that I cannot sin, but now I have a new heart and a new desire.
The desire that would keep you from, you know, wanting to live or enjoying the passions of life you used to enjoy.
Yes, yeah.
You know, as 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 2, chapter 2 verse 11 would say, beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh which war against your soul.
Yeah.
So your newness is that you are not now, as Paul would say in Romans, you are not now under the federal head, Adam.
Yes.
You are in Christ.
Now I'm in Christ.
And all you, so your newness is shown in the way you live your life.
Exactly.
In Galatians 5,
yes,
the Spirit is living in you. So you have these new cravings, which is a good craving. It's not like the old flesh that we used to crave against things.
That is it,
There's a love for God which really is consumes your heart. It's not a love for self. It's not a love for the things of this world.
Yes.
But also, as Jesus sums up in Matthew 22, you know, summing up the law, love the Lord your God with all your heart.
Yes.
Which again, he says also, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Love for God, love for man. They are so important things.
Exactly.
The book of 1 John would draw us to, if you don't love a brother.
Yeah.
So this new creature in Christ would say, you know, it is renewed in mind.
Exactly.
Desires that Christ becomes the everything in his life.
Exactly.
Whatever he does, this person is like, how is my Lord glorified?
Exactly. Yes.
How do I bring glory to my... It's not again about how do I enjoy personally.
Yeah.
You know, how do I show people I'm great, I'm might, I'm the king. Jesus is enthroned at the heart of that particular individual. We talk about, yet, as you have said, yet, there's no perfection here.
Exactly.
You know, we still struggle with the sin on a day-to-day basis.
Mm-hmm.
We are killing sin, as Paul calls us in Colossians 3.
Yeah, yeah.
Kill sin.
Exactly.
So sin is not something we enjoy, but on the other, we are striving to kill that which, you know, was parcel and pattern of our own.
Exactly.
Like, so the new creature, you would say, like, for example, if a Christian doesn't see himself striving in holiness, loving God more, you know, loving brethren more.
Exactly.
And he says he's a Christian. You know, he has no urge to do these things.
Exactly.
You'd completely...
You'd completely question that, because previously we have discussed from verse 1 to 3.
Yeah.
Of, from verse 1 to 3, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And we saw that naturally we walk, we follow the course of the world.
Yeah.
Just like a river will flow and just follow its course. In Kenya, we have several rivers.
Yes.
They are moved from the mountains to the lakes or the ocean, those that go at the coast. It is no struggle.
Yeah.
Those rivers will flow year in, year out. There is no struggle.
Yeah.
But now when you try to make water come from where they are going up, now there is energy.
Yes.
There is opposition. And so we are saying that a Christian is somebody who has tasted now from another world.
Mm.
Another world where the true God is only a Jehovah,
Amen.
Lord.
Amen.
The one who is worshipped.
Mm.
And me and you, we, of course, I believe, love the pictures we see in Revelation.
Mm.
The first chapter is that in heaven there is these songs of the angels and the saints as they are praising the one who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb.
Amen.
And there's the sevenfold, we are told sevenfold spirit of the living God. Just to show that perfection of the spirit of God. So the triune God in heaven is worship. So in this new creation, we taste that.
Amen.
That the one to be worshipped is God, not sin, not the world, not money.
Mm.
And as you're saying, not perfectly, mm-hmm. but those are the things that we start to see. These are our new nature now.
Yeah, yeah.
When I sin, when I act contrary to that nature, I grieve.
Mm.
There is repentance. There is crying out to God for help, for mercy, that I may grow, that I may mature, that this sin may not continue to flow me and to control me.
Mm.
There is now a cry.
Mm.
Somebody said that the difference now can be likened to a pig and a sheep. When you wash both of them, and they are clean. If you release them, the
pig will go back to
pig
its
will
mud.
Go back to its mud. Naturally, it will laugh as it is wallowing in the mud.
Yeah.
So, but the sheep will not. The sheep, if the sheep falls into the mud, it will actually start to bleat, to cry.
Yeah.
You know, I need help.
Yes.
And that's now there is now this tension.
Yeah.
A new creation will show in, now I got to fight.
Mm.
Fight the good fight.
Fight.
Yeah.
So we say believers are created in Christ Jesus,
mm-hmm.
okay,
yeah.
in union with Christ.
Yeah.
So they are made alive in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
They are united with Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah.
How important is this understanding in relation mm-hmm. to our growth
mm-hmm.
and the new life we are called to live?
Yeah, but it is very important because as we are saying, the new life, Hebrews 6 will tell us, we are tasting of the powers of the age to come.
Yeah.
A believer is somebody who is living in future world, in a perfection, in new creation. The creation has started with the resurrection of Jesus.
Mm.
In that sense, he is called the firstborn of creation from the dead, such that through him now the new creation is being brought into perfection. But it is not yet done.
Yeah.
So when we understand that our new creation is union with Jesus, then what we will do? We will seek more of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
We will now start to understand, even when I'm fighting with sin, I ought not to look to my resources. I ought to come to the well where life is flowing from, where is Christ is. In Hebrews 4, we are told to draw near to the throne of grace, that we may find mercy and grace to help us in time of need.
Mm.
So this union, I think in the Bible we are helped by the pictures that God gives.
Mm.
In John 15, Jesus himself will talk about the vine. And he will say, he is the vine. Maybe we can just read that in, from verse 1 of John 15. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Now we're talking about the means by which we are sanctified. Abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do
nothing.
So this new creation is in union with Jesus. It is in drawing, receiving what is his by the fellowship and work of the Holy Spirit. And we continue to be changed. And that is now the picture that we get.
In Ephesians 2:10, we are reminded, you know, we are God's workmanship.
Exactly.
Created in Christ Jesus to do good works.
Yeah.
Which these good works were prepared by God for us to do them before he laid any the creation, you know, before he laid anything
that is it.
To be created.
Mm-hmm.
How does it look like on a day to day, we being, you know, plugged into Christ?
Mm-hmm.
You know, how does it look like in a marriage?
Yeah.
for you to be plugged into Christ. Like, you know, he says, abide. What does it look like to abide in Christ?
Yeah.
Because we, you know, we don't want to talk about these things and, you know, up there. And if we are to tell, how does it look like to do good works? Because here we are talking about abiding in Jesus, doing works that bring glory to who? To the Lord Jesus Christ himself. You know, Galatians 5, walking in the fruit of the Spirit, and we have the fruit of the Spirit there. What does it mean to be faithful in a marriage?
So, and that is actually a very important question, because the Christian doctrine is not meant for these high sounding words and to make us feel as if we know so much. It is for practical living. And actually the book of Ephesians is such a well structured book. Of course it must be, it is inspired by the Holy Spirit. So the first thing that Paul will look at from chapter 2 and chapter 3 and 4 is that the practical way that we live and we show this union with Jesus is, first of all, daily union with his church, union with his body. So a believer ought to ask him or herself, how am I in a true way united with other believers? How am I keeping the unity, the bond of peace, the bond of unity through peace of the Spirit? How am I serving through gifts, the gifts Christ has given me? Because in chapter 4 he will say, when Christ is raised, he gave gifts to men. And also he called and equipped others to be apostles and pastors and teachers for the edification of the saints, the body, that the church may be built up and be mature, not being tossed to and fro. So how am I continuously today part of the church of Christ? How am I contributing to the health of other believers? How are they also speaking into my life and being part of my life?
What do you do exactly to do this? You know, what does it look like for me to be part of a church, to be part of, to be involved in the lives of fellow believers? How does it look like?
First of all, it means this letter is written to the church in Ephesus. It's a local church. So it means, first of all, being part of a local church. This means church membership. It is submitting myself to the biblical, a biblical church, where the gospel is preached, where the ordinances of the Lord, baptism, Lord's table, church discipline, is actually happening. And also, where I am receiving this word, and also I'm serving with my gifts. So this involves also being part of the lives of other believers. Somebody maybe in our church is needy, is sick, and I have here 1,000, I can spare 500 shillings. Am I being generous? Am I part of that brother, that sister's life? So my brother also is maybe passing through a battle with health or with sin or with various issues of life. Am I today part of that brother, that sister's life?
Am I looking from the fence and saying, hey, you know, it's up to him.
If
a brother is in need, I ask myself, you know, these are things we have to ask ourselves. Am I interested to see that person being a better person? Or asking ourselves, how much am I contributing in helping out a brother? Not only in need, you know, because people think being part of a church is just helping people, you know, me being part of help. It doesn't look like that. Even I think some of those who have been blessed by the Lord with the resources in the church, they need fellowship with others. Because, you know, we always say there's no man who is an island. And when it comes to Christianity, we are saying there's no man who lives by himself even in Christianity. That's why there is a body of believers. And so every Christian must ask himself, am I a Sunday guy? Or am I a guy or a person who on a day-to-day basis I'm involved in the life of a church?
That is it.
Am I going to prayer meetings? Am I, you know, encouraging my brothers during Bible studies? You know, how am I participating in encouraging the brother as the brother and the sister also? You know, they do what? Encourage me. So it's not, when you talk about church, it's not Sunday. When we talk about help, it's not just money. When we talk about fellowship, it's not just because he's sick. Because if we look at for that, what if the Lord decides nobody becomes sick? Nobody will be helping out each other.
Actually, we are saying this is it's life.
It's a life thing.
The way I do life with my wife and my children, is not programmed.
Let's talk about especially issues to do with the family. How does, you know, me and my wife, we are believers.
Yes.
How do you, as a husband, so that it does not become mechanical,
yeah.
I'm a husband. So how do I, on a day-to-day, be a husband to my wife, who is a Christian, and I'm a Christian also, how do I practice the gift of the Spirit, integrity, faithfulness, self-control, patience? How do I do that in a marriage? Because, you see, it is easy for us to practice these things in a church, talk about the body when we are together and so on, but in a home, brother, you become something else. Exactly. They know you, someone else, and outside they know you as someone else.
Exactly. Yeah, and this is now where we start to see Christianity as a counterculture. It is a new culture that is actually not part of this world.
Yeah.
As we are saying, union with Christ helps us understand now how we are called to live. Because we are taking values and principles and power and resources and grace from another world.
Yeah.
That is where Christ is, where God reigns.
Mm.
And so for husband, that means marriage will be marriage. Because marriage, we know, is not just taking a lady or a lady taking a man and going into the same house. And the two just remain to be two. Everyone with his own or her own priorities and values. And you live in a selfish way. The language of the Bible is the two will become one.
Yeah.
It's a clinging. And Ephesians 5 will also now bring us to that picture of marriage now ought to reveal the union or relationship between Christ and the church. The way that Christ laid down his life. Now, as a husband, my day-to-day living is about serving my wife. It's about being gentle with her and being kind with her. And of course, as we are saying, this is a battle. There's a conflict here.
There's a conflict here
because the old way of walking through the world is selfishness. It is harshness. It is settling scores. So she did not do this to me, so I will not do this to her. So it is actually trusting Christ to be able to serve and to love to be kind and to be gentle with my words, to be faithful with not only to say that I am not being with another woman, but also in my mind and my affections, she is the one that.
Because, you know, that's a great point.
Yeah.
When we think about faithfulness, people only think about which we agree, all of us, like faithfulness means honoring. It means, but doesn't mean honoring. I don't have someone else outside
exactly.
there. You know, being faithful to my wife means, yes, I don't have someone else there, but also there are other values of being faithful to your wife
exactly.
that we don't want to glue it only on infidelity. But also that we practice faithfulness in our homes. You know, things like, you know, even simple things. Do you lie to your wife?
Yeah, the temptation is there,
isn't it? Because people are like, I can lie to her, but as long as I don't I don't do this particular issue. And the other thing is, when we talk about good works, people should not also think about just you know, helping the poor, isn't it?
Yes.
Helping the needy, helping the widow, helping the orphan.
Yeah.
They are good works, but they are not the
only
good works.
Yeah.
And so we want also, as we wind up, to ask ourselves this, because, you know, we are producing a magazine that should be out probably mid-October. You know, we are looking at the gospel life, you know, how the gospel becomes real in our day-to-day life, and I think we will have episodes also on the gospel life, just to try and battle with these things that we are battling with in our day-to-day life. Because remember, we have been taken from somewhere. We have been brought here. Now we have to battle to live this life here.
We are in a totally new world.
Totally new world, and we have to make sure we live there. We are not going back there.
That is it.
So now, what's the difference between saying we are not saved by good works, but we must do good works?
The difference is the core or the definition of the gospel is something that God does. And that, I think, has already been laid so clear by now somebody who has followed. knows that from verse 1 we said we did not want to be saved.
Yeah.
Personally, I did not want to be saved.
Yes.
And actually, by the language of the Bible, we did not want to be saved.
No, no one.
We wanted to continue in sin until God, by his mercy, stopped us and awakened our eyes and our hearts to his glory. And from there, if you ask yourself, what did I do to come to that point?
Mm.
It is actually nothing.
Yeah.
It is actually by the grace of God.
Mm.
Ephesians 2, verse 8, that's what we learn.
Yeah,
by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing.
Mm.
It is a gift of God. And up there, down there in verse 9, he says, so that no one may boast before
yeah.
God.
Yeah.
But also, these other face of the coin, as we are saying, we have been brought into a new world.
Yes.
Totally new world with new values, with new motivations.
Yes.
Now, as a person who is employed, I will not work with the same values as the world.
Yes.
I will not work because that which I'm pursuing is my God.
Mm.
But I work because is a means to serve
the Lord.
Is a means to serve my family. It's a means to contribute to the needs of others.
Yes.
Now, the money is not my God.
No.
Already we have seen now a new work has happened.
A new concept of how I look at work.
Exactly.
Which I think even Christians must...
Yes, exactly.
We must learn from that.
We must learn,
because sometimes when we go to work, it's about money.
Mm-hmm.
It's about money alone. And
we
must work to earn money.
Yes.
But it's not just about money alone.
Exactly,
it's about we are serving the Lord.
Yeah.
Now, the other question I would ask that, if I'm faithful at work, if I'm faithful to my wife, if I'm faithful in the community, I'm not a drunkard, you know, I'm one of the greatest preachers in Kenya, you know, my church is big, you know, truly the Lord has used me.
Yeah.
Is that a mark of my salvation, or am I doing things to earn my salvation?
That is, if it flows from the work of the gospel, that is a mark of the salvation. It is a mark of this new creation. How does it show itself?
Mm.
We all know that when you plant a seed, every seed will behave in its own unique way.
Yeah.
Because you don't have to force it. If there's a seed that... when it is sunny, it dries, that's what it will do.
Yeah.
If it is windy, it's so weak, it breaks, that's what it will do. So we are saying this new life in Christ is a new creation that shows itself in a certain way. And that's why, as you said, Galatians 5 from 22, after saying the way we were naturally were before Christ, it is to walk in sexual immorality, in drunkenness, in debauchery, in selfishness, in anger, in wrath, in violence, in all these malice and conniving and corruption.
Yeah.
But now, in verse 22, he says, but this new creation that is in Jesus will show itself in a different way, if it is real. So as you're saying, faithful in your work, in your calling as a pastor, preaching the truth, not falsehood, bring up your family in the ways of the Lord, loving your wife.
Yeah.
This will be marks of what Jesus has done.
Yes.
And you see, you will not even boast in them because it's the work of God.
Yeah.
Philippians 2, 12 to 13.
Mm.
It is God who is at work in us.
Mm.
So in salvation and in the fruit of it, a Christian is bound to say glory to God who gives me grace to continue like this.
Now, if you have the next door neighbor who... you know, he doesn't beat the wife.
Mm-hmm.
He's the most faithful guy to the wife.
Mm-hmm.
Loves the children very much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's not a drunkard.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's probably talked well about in the community.
Mm-hmm.
And he's not a believer. Probably he has, you know, he goes to church, but he has not trusted in Christ.
Yeah.
Are you going to say, brother, you are going to heaven? In fact, not brother. Hey, ndugu, unaenda binguni wewe.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if people would ask you, is this guy, you know, people tell you, why don't you emulate that brother?
Mm-hmm.
What would you say?
Yeah.
And he's not a believer,
mm-hmm.
but he's morally, he's upright.
Yes.
Why don't you emulate this guy?
Exactly.
Because frankly speaking,
mm-hmm.
there are some Christians,
mm-hmm.
there are some non-Christians
exactly.
who in some ways beat we believers in the good works in terms of the way they behave.
Exactly.
They beat us 100, you know, you look at it like, wow. And we are not saying there's nothing to emulate in such characters.
Exactly.
There is, but unfortunately, they're not going to heaven.
Exactly.
Because you don't enter heaven by your good
works.
Your good works.
Exactly.
Although God has saved us to do good
works.
Exactly. And we are saying, you are saying that the basis of the believer's works is not because he's looking for salvation, but is to obedience and to please the master who has saved that particular individual.
That is it.
And that's a very clear thing because, you know, the religion, you know, many religious organizations teach good works.
Yeah,
you know, if you give, you remember in Luke 18,
yeah.
you know, I pray, you know, I give, I'm not like this particular,
this other
person. And unfortunately, there are people who have been deceived that in their goodness, the doors of heaven just, you know, just, they're just flown open for them to get in. And I think probably there are many who have been astonished once they have lived this life.
That is it. That is it. Because human, and actually you're right, the human energy can be channeled towards great good. Even moral good. But the motivation and at the root, the core of the being, it is not the glory of God that is being sought.
No.
And so we are not denying that somebody can, by effort, change the outlook, the appearance, and actually,
and they contribute to the goodness of the society.
Exactly. Yeah. And also, we ought not forget also, it is God's common grace that is also giving people such kind of ability. Because somebody cannot do good unless he has the material ability, or the finances, or the restraining grace of God that somehow makes, he is selfish, but he will not be selfish to the point of not of taking it all.
Yeah.
But the selfishness is still there.
Mm.
Pride is still there.
Yeah.
I can love my wife not because I'm motivated by the glory of God, but because I fear.
Mm.
I fear scandals.
Yes.
I fear that when a scandal comes, my job will go away, my money will go away, my position in society will go away. So there are very many motivations that may cause people to modify their behavior, which is not bad.
You know, because you're like, I don't want my job to go away.
Exactly.
But again, is that loving? Is that loving your wife?
That's actually loving myself.
That's loving yourself.
That's loving myself. I can do good in the society because I need a seat in 2022.
Yeah.
And which is also, if I pay some school fees for some orphans, it's good to the community, but it is not God I'm serving, ultimately. It is myself. And actually, I'll get my reward because people may vote you in.
Yeah.
You eat more.
Yeah. Viewers, so, we are very, we regret because our time is really has run out. But we are so thankful for being with us just to get deeper into these things. Remember, some of the things we discuss here, we have a magazine that we do quarterly. And those magazines are free. You are free to pick, to order some copies which you would like to use with your church or for your own personal use. They are free of charge. You can always contact us at Covenant Baptist Church. As we said, we are on Facebook, Covenant Baptist Church. You can visit our website, cbcnakuru.org. It's been a good discussion, and we hope we are learning together. One of the things we wouldn't want as we discuss this matter is that you to be deceived, that you have good works to save you. But at the same time, if you are a Christian, also not to sit down. Your salvation is not passive. God is calling you to work. And as you work, remember, you don't work for your own praise. You work for the glory and the honor of God. And some of these good works as Christians you're going to do, they might not be appreciated by anybody in this world. Nobody will ever come to you and say, thank you all, well done. But if it's for the Lord, God will be honored. Thank you for watching today. Hope to see you again next Tuesday. God bless you and keep well.